Hello, everybody, and welcome to BEAST, Festival of Central and Eastern European Film, taking place in Porto. Today we'll be talking about Mirages of Freedom, a project in collaboration with Dovzhenko-Centr in Kyiv, Ukraine. And we have with us as a guest Oleksandr Teliuk. He's the head of archive department of Dovzhenko-Centr. Hello, Oleksandr. Thank you very much for joining me in this interdigital corner.
Hello. Nice to be here and to talk with you about this program.
Hello, nice to meet you too, and thank you so much for joining us today. And I have to say I'm very excited about this program, and I think it's a great addition to the festival. And yes, we get a chance to talk a bit more about it. Through this project, we get a chance to travel through a period of change, a period of transition. So taking this specific period, like 1960s, 1980s, what do we know about this revival and development of experimental cinema in Ukraine?
Okay. Firstly, if we are talking about revival, we need to talk about, I think, the roots of the Ukrainian avant-garde cinema, Ukrainian experimental cinema. And I want to pay attention on what we call experimental cinema as such, because we have a lot of definition from scholars and theoretics, what it is, but it is, we have also this common sense that it is a cinema that tends to be out of some aesthetical and distribution conventions of classical cinema. First of all, some realistic narrative psychological cinema, but the situation in USSR and in Ukraine, I think, was a bit different than in Europe or in USA. The situation of how classical cinema film industry worked, and consequently how experimental cinema answered to this classical cinema. It is important to say that it is appeared not from the some underground or some art, contemporary art area, but mostly from classical film studios, and this experimental cinema and directors and authors of this cinema need to have some cunning strategies how to avoid censorship, which was one of the main quality of the Soviet cinema, Soviet film system and film industry. And these strategies were different in different times. And after Second World War, it was possible to appear for that cinema only in some marginal studios, in some small studios, and in some types of cinema as students' films, scientific documentary, and amateur films.
Yeah, it was like it was a strong search of freedom, as the title of the project says. And for the films that we have in the program, we see like the early careers of some iconic filmmakers that are mm-hmm. present here. And then we have the Ukrainian poetic cinema, and then we have the student amateur film. And what is the transition of this space, let's say so-called 60s movement, and the student mm-hmm. amateur film in the program, like because I know it's divided in basically two parts. They are together, but like we can see both of these sides, the Ukrainian poetic cinema and the search of freedom through the student amateur film that was made by them.
Only in the second half of 20th century, in 60s, this censorship restriction was easier to struggle with, and it creates some context, some new context for revival. And of course, we need to mention the School of Ukrainian Poetic Cinema of 60s. It was it inspired a lot of young people how they could use a camera and what topic they can talk about. But it was a very short period after this destalinization in Soviet in USSR and separately in Soviet Ukraine. And it was after the film The Shadows of Forgotten Ancestors, after the premiere of this film, this period started to go to the end. And when we are talking about Ukrainian poetic cinema, we, as a point of this new develop of some poetic or unconventional cinema, it is we need to say that it is a very short period, and it is a very small quantity of films. And after this, after new restrictions appeared, there are only not so many areas where this free voice of cinema could sound, and there was just very poor and very small film studios like Kyiv Scientific Documentary Film Studio, and like and also like University of Cinema in Kyiv, where just students could where censorship was weaker, and students could involve some poetic cinema discovers in their own movies.
Yeah. And I'm curious, because there is a certain level of activism you have in the films made by the students, and they have like a power against the regime and against the censorship. So how do you find this in the relation with the films?
Okay, we have in program, I think it's important to say that we have in program Sergei Parajanov film, and also Leonid film, who were the directors of Ukrainian poetic cinema. They were from older generation, but after Kyiv Frescoes, Sergei Parajanov's films was his last film in Ukraine, and it have some motifs of Ukrainian poetic cinema. And for Leonid films, it was his students' film, but Entering the Sea. But the new generation, the students who tried to follow them, also, I think, knew about these works, because these films, especially Kyiv Frescoes, which it was banned, and there wasn't no distribution of these films, but in cinemas. But I think teachers, masters in university could show these films for students, and also Shadows of Forgotten Ancestor. It has short distribution in cinemas, but the premiere, I don't know, do you know, I think know that the premiere of this film was also the political action, and it was some arrests after this screening, and this the start of new repression in Soviet Ukraine. But so it wasn't very good way for students who want to follow this poetic aesthetic, but anyhow, it was so strong and so interesting that some of them start to use it. For example, Roman Balayan, who we have here in Dovzhenko Centre, we have an exhibition of his later film, but in the program that you have at the festival, you can discover his very early film, A Thief, which is very in this poetic style, which has a broken narrative position and very interesting cinematography, because it uses long shots and it uses interesting montage and this black and white image. So it, this looking to on this film, you can imagine how all this Ukrainian poetic cinema school looks.
Yes, so the film are also like an act of memory, and they subvert the notion of lost traditions. And I'm curious, what do you think about the ethnographic value of the films? Rather than seeing the films as oriented towards the past, they are kind of anchored in the present, and they remembrance of traditions, and it's quite present in the idea of the program.
Okay, I think that this interest to ethnography in that time, it was as just an answer for the restrictions that we had in Soviet era in before 60s. So 60s was a period when the director, the artist of that time could and they, after the Sergei Parajanov, they choose these ethnographic motifs as one of the common motifs for them. I think that I need to add that this phenomenon, Ukrainian poetic cinema, was just a very small part of Ukrainian cinema in general, and it was a kind of new wave movement which appeared in all over the Europe, but is the specific part of this movement was of course the idea of its interest to some national identity, and the leader of this generation, Sergei Parajanov, in his for him it also was his personal interest and one of the main line and main topic of his the shadows of forgotten ancestors. But for other representatives of the generation, they anyhow they had more classical film styles, and only this interest to ethnographic motifs was the point that allows us to call them like a school, like a group, and it wasn't the main line for next generation of cinematography of the directors and authors. And how you can discover in this program, the ethnographic motifs is not very strong. If, for example, in amateur cinema or in animation cinema from scientific documentary film studio, but only of course after USSR collapsed, these motifs appeared again in, but not only in experimental and avant-garde cinema, but mostly in some classical films, and it became really mainstream topic for Ukrainian 90s. But it was other story because in that time experimental cinema tried to find new topics and new identities, and it wasn't only ethnographic or
mm-hmm. Yeah, we have the Ukrainian poetic cinema, and like I was curious, how do you think this is still present in the representations of of the Ukrainian film industry nowadays? How do you think that this is still present in what we see now from Ukraine, from what Ukraine has to offer in terms of cinema?
Yes. As I told you before, this poetic style in this school was like bright phenomenon, but very short. And of course, we feel it influence for current Ukrainian cinema, but anyhow, it wasn't the only style that Ukrainian cinema created in that time, and it's a bit artificial way to connect all these political films as some strong movement. That's why, of course, it is interesting. These new revivals of Ukrainian poetic cinema, it is interesting to find them in new films, and we have a lot of examples in contemporary Ukrainian cinema when some films try to use this aesthetic, but it doesn't work well because it could work only if it is part of some struggle against walls and against restriction, how it was in the 60s. But when it is a part of some mainstream convention, I think it not work, even if it is very similar in aesthetic way, it is not work in a political way. That's why it only in 60 was a very interesting short period when it really worked, this poetic and aesthetic, which include also these ethnographical motifs and this interesting new wave of how to shoot film and how to edit it. But I would repeat that it is not the only and the main motif of Ukrainian cinema of second part of 20th century. It's just a point where experimental cinema, in Ukrainian experimental cinema, which wasn't a school, but it was some different personalities, different authors and directors, point where they could find their influence for how to create interesting works in Soviet system, in Soviet film industry.
Yes, and I think having such a project presented nowadays, especially in this virtual interaction for an online festival, it's kind of showing how much things have moved on and moved forward. And I'm curious about the Dovzhenko Centre. Like, you are doing a continuous work on archive and the process. And I know that you actually, you're based in a factory in Kyiv, if I'm not mistaken, which is pretty interesting and pretty impressive that you managed to develop such projects and to establish yourself as a relevant institution from Ukraine. So congrats on that. And how is it working with future projects in terms of archive and maybe growing this type of projects like Mirages of Freedom or something that you're going to present soon in this sense?
I'm really happy that you know about our history, that we are really have our institution in previous factory. So it was industrial building, but now it is a film museum, and it open for visitors, and we show some films and have some presentation, and it's very open space now and quite contemporary way how contemporary archive could work. And we also part of a member of FIAF, International Federation of Film Archives. So we're the only institution who work with film history and our memory as a part of cinema history. And yet it's a very usual practice for us to create such kind of programs. It's not the only our program. We had a lot of programs about different periods from the past, from Ukrainian, about Ukrainian cinema. But what is specific about this program, that it is, I think, our first program which discover the experimental films and show this movement and this part of films which were not created by the government, by the state film studios. Some of them was, but we have also these amateur films. So it's a new way how we could work with our archive, because we have this transition in 90s and in 2000s when we have in our collection only films from state studios, but after until now we are trying to preserve and to invite authors and artists to give us film, even if it is not state funding, but also independent funding, which is, I think, important in our time. So it's really great that your festival also could show this program and this small but very.
Yeah, we're also very happy that we managed to have the program part of BEAST, and especially because it's online and available online for free for the audience, makes it even better. And I hope that we'll have a quite big online digital audience for it. Going a bit back on the history, like you were specifying the screening of Kyiv Sketch, that it was problematic, and we have it as a kind of important point, let's say, of the history of this movement, of these films. What else can we find from these backstories of the program in terms of the Poetic School and also the amateur films that came right afterwards?
Yes, as we mentioned, we have two, or we can say even three parts of in this program, and one of them is this directors. They were real stars like Sergei Parajanov or Roman Balayan. And they were well known, even not with these films, but with other films. There are a lot of articles and studies about them. But of course, we have this other part of the program, which is not well known even in Ukraine. So it's very interesting topic to discover more. And first of all, it's this amateur films. It is a really big topic now because our film archive, and as I know, other film archives started to look up on these films to try to find new authors who were not professional directors, but more like amateurs. And of course, my favorite, I have a few favorite names here. Of course, it's Mykola Peretyatko. He wasn't a director, he was just a school teacher and engineer, but he had a camera because after the 70s, it was quite cheap to have your own camera in USSR and in Ukraine. So he was just a possibility to shoot his daily life, but he made it in some poetic way. So that's why we include a part of his films to this program. It wasn't really a film because he didn't even, his work didn't have a title, or and it was a different duration, but a part of his footage is just how an example of how this amateur people and filmmakers worked. The other example is the first film of the program. Okay, you will have it online, but when we showed them in Ukraine, it was the first first film. It was a film to Yugoslavia by Andrei Tuzek and Oleg Kachmar. They are from Lviv. It's not Kyiv as a capital where the Dovzhenko Centre is, but they are from Lviv, the other big Ukrainian city. And there were students of medical institute, and just to have fun with their camera, to play some dramas and comedies, but in amateur way. And the example of their footage is this very short part tour to Yugoslavia. But of course, I can also pay your attention to these animation films that we have. The authors were not amateurs, they were professional directors and animators, but they worked in late 80s when the system became broke, and they were they have their own film studio, but as a part of this scientific documentary film studio, and they had enough of freedom to create very weird films, animated works. And of course, it is also a phenomenon that even in Ukraine, we need to discover more. And I'm glad that you could also have a possibility to show these films, like Mosaics by Vladimir Rublevsky, or The True Close Up by Vladimir Goncharov, the statement against the censorship that was in USSR, but in the 80s it became weaker. So the program is really, really very complex, really a lot of lines to discover, but I hope you would it helps you to understand these different directions that were in this late Ukrainian cinema, Soviet Ukrainian cinema, or Ukrainian cinema after this poetic wave.
Yes, I think it's interesting because we have this part of stagnation in the program, and then we have this very big expansion of amateur films, of basically it's light, and it's you can see it's full of energy, and I think it's very interesting and very unique to be able to see such iconic filmmakers at the same time having these films made by the students. I think it's a great mix, and hopefully you'll be able to grow the project more and to maybe present it on a bigger scale as well in the future. And really congrats on that, and we are honored to host this program.
Yes, thank you very much for this contribution, and really, really hope that you like it.
Yes, I think that our audience is going to be very happy with the whole experience. Thank you very much for joining today, and
thank you. We
will be in touch throughout the festival online, and hopefully we'll be able to meet in person as well at some point in Porto or in Kyiv, who knows. I'm very curious to visit your center.
Yeah, I invite you to come if you will hear. It's very interesting to show you how it really works.
I'll be more than excited. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Bye.